Welcome to a new session of IntelliQuest's The World's 100 Greatest Book Series. In this session, we'll introduce you to an early 19th century author who invented and pioneered a completely new literary form, historic fiction. The author is Sir Walter Scott, and by the end of this session, you'll have a deeper understanding of why his works have left such an indelible mark on the history of Western literature, and why, even today, he continues to be an influence on writers of both fiction and poetry. We'll also explore in depth one of his most popular and successful works, the narrative poem, The Lady of the Lake. We'll begin with the background of Sir Walter Scott himself, his life, his work, and the times in which he lived. Scott was both a poet and a novelist, and in both genres he was astonishingly prolific. At his peak in the early 1800s, he wrote 20 of his best novels in only 11 years. His first novel was entitled Waverley, and that book, and the 31 that followed, are referred to as the Waverley novels. That's because Scott wrote these novels anonymously, identifying himself only as the author of Waverley. He kept his identity secret because at that time novels were considered an inferior form of literature, and no one believed that a true artist or genius would write them. Scott did not remain anonymous for long, and his many and varied works soon established him as the most popular writer in what is known as the Romantic period, a period that began at the end of the 18th century in about 1798 and lasted until 1825, a little over a quarter of a century. Through his remarkable books, Scott invented a form of literature completely unknown before that time and still popular today, the historic romance, or the modern historical novel. Scott chose settings and characters from the long-ago past and used them to weave stories and themes that had contemporary and timeless value. Although he preferred Scottish settings and characters, he also explored other countries and cultures. Scott's special ability was in creating exciting dramatic stories, placing them against the backdrop of some famous historic event, and enriching his story with detailed descriptions that vividly evoked the past. These descriptions included every aspect of life in a bygone era, the fashions, architecture, customs and manners, even the language and dialects. They were so intricate and rich that they immediately captured the imagination of all who read them. These elaborate descriptions are partly what Scott is famous for. In his books, one can find paragraphs and paragraphs of lengthy description, sometimes of just one object, one place, or one person. Even when these passages don't enhance the plot, even when they distract or confound us. To his critics, this is a flaw, but it is this ability to paint a multidimensional image of the past that helped broaden our sense of history and which set the style for historic fiction for many years to come. Sir Walter Scott has been the inspiration for many writers and artists that followed him, some of whom are featured in our other sessions, such as James Fenimore Cooper, Charles Dickens, Robert Louis Stevenson, Victor Hugo, and Leo Tolstoy. Before Scott, chronicles of the past were dull, factual, and linear. But Scott, inspired by writers like Homer and Shakespeare, was able to marry history with fiction and produce a progeny of such charm and vitality that it attracted not only readers, but generations of authors. Sir Walter Scott was undeniably an action writer. His stories rely far more on events and incidents than they do on depth of character. He is not a psychological writer and makes little attempt to explore and analyze the deeper motivation of his characters. He is also not considered a master of plot. Frequently, his plots are beset by contradictions, flaws, and inconsistencies. But he is a supreme storyteller. His stories are stirring and enchanting, and although he seldom offers us characters who think remarkable thoughts, he does offer us characters who do remarkable things. To understand how Scott accomplished this and what formed and influenced his work, let's now examine his life and the times in which he wrote. Sir Walter Scott was born on August 15, 1771, in Edinburgh, Scotland, at a time when his country was experiencing a golden age in the arts and sciences. His famous contemporaries include the philosopher David Hume, economist Adam Smith, and writers like Robert Burns and James Boswell. From childhood, Scott loved the ancient ballads and folk tales that glorified Scotland's past. He suffered a long illness as a child that left him partially lame, possibly polio, and while recovering at his grandfather's farm, he spent his time reading and listening to stories. This is where his passion for history and storytelling had its birth. Eventually, Scott went to Edinburgh to study law. He was admitted to the bar in 1792 and for a brief time led a traditional life. He had a well-paying job, married and fathered four children, and seemed to embody the middle-class values of his parents and social class. But the romance of the past had a stronger pull than the law, and he began traveling into the countryside, collecting ballads and tales about historic heroes and events. By the beginning of the next century, around 1802 or 1803, his writings about these travels had been published, and soon he would also write seven long narrative poems based on the ballads and legends he'd heard in the countryside. Scott's poems catapulted him to fame. But in 1813, Lord Byron published Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, and overnight he had replaced Scott as England's favorite poet. This was perhaps a blessing in disguise. Having lost his place as first poet and burdened by tremendous financial debts, Scott decided to complete a discarded manuscript for a novel called Waverley. This novel and the 31 that followed launched a new career and brought him lasting fame as the creator of the historic romance. His most famous of these included Rob Roy, Guy Mannering, Old Mortality, The Talisman, Quentin Durward, Anne of Geierstein, and Ivanhoe, which is featured in the following session of our series. Although it was common knowledge that Scott authored these works, he didn't formally admit it until 1827, 13 years after Waverley was published. In 1820, as an expression of regard for his unique contributions to literature, Scott was named Baronet, and forever after was known by the title of Sir. During this period, Scott had accumulated massive debts. At great expense, he had built a family estate at Abbotsford, where he entertained lavishly. He had also invested in a printing firm which had failed. The enormous success of his novels was still not enough to relieve Scott of these debts, which amounted to over $500,000, a staggering sum for the times. But rather than declare bankruptcy, he took personal responsibility for the debts and began to churn out novels at incredible speed in hopes of repaying them. By publishing an average of one book a year, he eventually cleared his name and freed his beloved Abbotsford of all debts, but at immense cost to his health. In 1831, exhausted by overwork, he set out on a cruise to Italy to recuperate, but found instead that he longed for his home. He returned and died shortly after at Abbotsford at the age of 62. Before Scott had established himself as a novelist and gave the world an entirely new form of fiction, he had already gained renown as a poet. His narrative poems were the natural vehicle for the legends and ballads he had collected while traveling the countryside as a young man. In the beginning years of the 19th century, from about 1804 on, Scott began to translate these stories into romantic poems that soon established him as England's favorite poet. He gained even more popularity than his famous English contemporaries, Samuel Taylor Coleridge and Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Scott's most successful poems included Lay of the Last Minstrel, Marmion, and the one featured in this session, The Lady of the Lake. In 1813, at the time he published the poem Rokeby, Scott was offered the Poet Laureateship of England, an honor he declined. It was about this same time that Lord Byron appeared and usurped Scott's position as England's first poet. Scott's poetry, like his novels, is distinctive for its ability to both spin an adventurous tale and to bring history vividly to life. In fact, he is often referred to by scholars as a writer with a sense of the past. This sense of the past means two things. First of all, Scott, like many writers before him, realized that human nature remains eternally the same, and that the feelings, thoughts, and motivations of people today are no different than those of people 100 years ago. And even 1,000 years ago. All the passions and desires of the human experience, love, hate, greed, power, lust, sacrifice, devotion, etc., are played out over and over again in different settings and times. These truths enable a writer to set his stories in any era he wishes and still explore themes and issues that have immediate relevance to his readers. The advantage is that the reader can approach them with more detachment and distance, and therefore perhaps with greater clarity. Scott, like Shakespeare and dozens of other classic writers, Use the past to identify and explore issues that are timeless and universal. But there is something else that is meant by Scott's sense of the past, and it is something that separated him from all other writers before him. Scott consciously chose to focus on the differences between the past and present. In fact, he took great delight in researching and describing these differences. For although human nature never changes, the props, costumes, scenes, and dialogue with which we express that nature are constantly changing. Scott's innovation was to assume that the past and the present were alike, and to concentrate instead on the ways in which they were different. Those differences get down to the details of daily life, to what people wore, their manners, their dialects, the architecture and foods of the time, the religious rites and political structures. Sir Walter Scott was the first author to devote himself to these intricate details of what might be called the surface of life. And he did so from his first writings, and he did so passionately. He studied the fashions and manners of 16th century Scotland before he penned The Lady of the Lake, just as he studied the fashions and manners of 12th century England before writing his novel Ivanhoe. In particular, Scott studied language and dialects. Since ancient dialects couldn't be understood by modern readers, he couldn't use them in his works in exact detail, but he did strive to pepper his dialogue with authentic expressions and sentence constructions, while also avoiding the use of modern allusions and terms. This way, he achieved an effect of authenticity that lent his characters and stories greater credibility and certainly made his writing more colorful. Readers had never before been so fully transported to a bygone era. Never before had the people and events of the past seemed so real. The Lady of the Lake was published in the year 1810. In that year, Napoleon was at his zenith, the young democracy of America had elected its fourth president, James Madison, and in the fine arts, Ludwig von Beethoven was transforming music, while Francisco Goya was transforming painting. The Lady of the Lake was recognized immediately as a classic example of a form Scott had explored in earlier poems such as Marmion, the story in verse. The accomplishment of The Lady of the Lake is that above all else, the beauty of the language and the imagery aside, it manages to tell an exciting, compelling story that moves steadily onwards to a dramatic and happy ending. The poem reflects Scott's incomparable skill as a storyteller, and contains many of the elements that distinguished his other stories and that are typical of the writer of romance. The mysterious character whose true identity isn't revealed until close to the conclusion. The occult figure borrowed from Shakespeare who prophesies the outcome. The varied suitors who all compete for the same woman. The brave and pure heroine. The tournaments, battles, and castles. The twists of plot that are completely predictable but surprise us nevertheless. In The Lady of the Lake, we see the clear influence of Scott's childhood and his early fascination with ballads and legends. The characters and stories he accumulated while traveling the Scottish countryside have their perfect opportunity for expression in this tale of the clash between two clans under the reign of King James. In homage to his love for ballads and balladeers, he has even created a character who sings part of the story to us, another technical innovation for his times. The servant of one of the lead characters happens also to be a minstrel, and when it is time to retell the events of a day's battle, the minstrel sings his description to a dying chieftain who has missed the battle. It is not dissimilar to a tactic Scott used in Ivanhoe, where, as you may recall, he had Rebecca describe the battle to Ivanhoe as she watched from a castle window. That scene was also an innovation, this time in the genre of novels, because it marked the first time a character described an event to the readers as a witness describing it to another character. Both these techniques are more significant than they seem and reveal an important aspect of Scott's character. Scott was sympathetic to the pacifist point of view and abhorred violence and bloodshed, particularly when it seemed futile or was the result of bigotry or fanatical idealism. So he seemed to search for and to find creative ways to remove himself from his battle scenes, allowing the reader to experience them from a distance, immune to the ugly details. Although Scott seemed to abhor violence, he was nevertheless drawn to stories of cultures and peoples in conflict. The Lady of the Lake is no exception. In this poem, the opposing forces are two Scottish clans, the Celtic Highlanders, members of the clan Alpine, and the Saxon Lowlanders. The Highlanders and Saxons were different in temperament, in style, and in political allegiance, and they shared the mutual prejudice against each other that is so often a theme in Scott's works. In Ivanhoe, as you'll learn in our next session, he dramatized the prejudice between Normans and Saxons in England. In this earlier work, he chose to stay close to home and explore the historic divisions between his own countrymen. The Saxon lowlanders of Scotland were a peaceful agrarian race that devoutly followed their country's king, at this time King James. The Highlanders were fiercer and wilder, with a somewhat tribal nature. They were loyal only to their chieftain, and they resented the Saxons who had confiscated much of their homeland and forced them into the rugged, infertile highlands. Scott offers us compelling characters from both cultures and allows each to present his point of view, creating sympathy and understanding for both sides. The first character we meet is a Saxon knight who is on a stag hunt in the Highlands. It is a scene typical of Scott, exciting and action-filled, and an appropriate opening for the absorbing tale that is to follow. But before we begin that tale, let's first meet the six main characters in The Lady of the Lake. The principal characters are James Douglas, the outlawed uncle of the Earl of Angus, who in spite of his expulsion still remains loyal to the king. He is now settled in the Highlands, where he lives with his daughter on an island in Loch, or Lake, Catrin. Ellen Douglas, James' daughter, the Lady of the Lake for whom the poem is named. She is lovely, noble, and true, as all Scott's heroines are. She is also the unifying element in the story, since she is loved by all the opposing forces, her outlaw father, the embittered Highlander, and the Saxon noble. Roderick Dhu, a rebel Highland chief of the Clan Alpine. He is cousin and protector to the Douglases and hopes to marry Ellen. He is also somewhat belligerent and harbors no love for the Saxons. James Fitzjames, a Saxon knight from the lowlands who becomes lost in the Highlands during a hunting trip. He is enthralled by the beautiful Ellen, who offers him shelter. Malcolm Graham, the young Highlander whom Ellen loves. Alan Bane, the Douglas devoted servant, who is also a minstrel. The story of the Lady of the Lake opens in the Highlands of Scotland in the 16th century. James Fitzjames, a Saxon knight from Stirling Castle, is on a hunting trip, but he's become lost. He sounds his horn, hoping his comrades will hear and rescue him. Instead, the horn is heard by Ellen Douglas, a beautiful young woman who lives on a nearby loch with her father, under the protection of her Highlander cousin, Roderick Dhu. Although the men are currently away, Ellen takes Fitzjames in and extends the warm hospitality for which the Highlanders are famous. Fitzjames discerns a resemblance between the girl and members of the hunted Douglas clan, but he is enchanted by her beauty and kindness and dismisses his concerns. That night he dreams of her as he sleeps. The next morning, Fitzjames leaves the island, this time with a guide. After he leaves, the men return from their separate journeys. Ellen's father, James Douglas, arrives in the company of young Malcolm Graham, Ellen's suitor. Roderick Dhu, cousin and protector of the Douglases, also arrives. Roderick is a middle-aged warrior with a fierce countenance and equally fierce ways. He hopes to marry Ellen, but his motives are political as well as emotional. Although he loves the girl, he also realizes their marriage would unite the Douglas and Alpine clans, creating a strong political force. Ellen is appreciative of Roderick's protection, but she has no desire to marry him. His gruff manners frighten her, and she is already in love with Malcolm Graham, whom Roderick despises. Roderick proposes marriage to Ellen in front of the entire company. Malcolm can see that Ellen is upset by the offer, but before he can intervene, her father speaks, explaining tactfully that the marriage would be a political misalliance. Roderick is a sworn enemy of the king, and he, Douglas, is still devoted to the monarch, in spite of his outlaw status. Roderick can neither understand nor accept Douglas' loyalty. That loyalty, coupled with the rejection of his offer of marriage, inflames Roderick. He sends out an ominous signal, the fiery cross that summons his clan Alpine to war. The cross is carried over the rocky highlands, and all along the way, clansmen rally to support their chieftain in his challenge to the Saxons. Roderick visits Brian the Hermit, who possesses magical powers. He asks him for an augury of the impending battle, and Brian reads the following oracle: "Which spills the foremost foeman's life that party conquers in the strife. Interpreted, the oracle means that whichever clan is the first to kill a foe is the clan that will be victorious. It is a prediction that fills Roderick with confidence. The warriors of Clan Alpine have been the first to kill a foe in every battle they've fought. Meanwhile, James Douglas has decided to give himself up to the king in hopes of persuading the Saxons to avert the war. Before setting out for Stirling Castle to surrender, he escorts his daughter to the safety of a wilderness cave, leaving their faithful servant, Alan Bane, with her for protection. Ellen knows her father's intentions and exclaims, "He goes to do what I had done had Douglas' daughter been his son." Ellen and Alan Bane are discovered by James Fitzjames, who is returning to see if he can persuade Ellen to accompany him home to Stirling Castle. Ellen is alarmed. She asks him, hasn't he seen the preparations for war? Has he not noticed that the hills around them are alive with Roderick's men? Fitzjames says he has seen nothing. In fact, the countryside appears still and serene. Now Ellen is even more alarmed, for this can only be a sign of increasing danger. The clever men of Clan Alpine must already have surrounded him. Ellen promises to help Fitzjames escape, although she tells him that her heart really belongs to Malcolm Graham. Fitzjames, however, is determined to help Ellen save her father. He gives her a royal Saxon ring, saying it will aid her on her journey through the lowlands and will gain her audience with King James. Fitzjames departs, still accompanied by his guide, Red Murdoch. Soon they encounter Blanche, a madwoman living in the wilds. From his hunting green, Blanche can tell that Fitzjames is a fellow lowlander. She tells him that years ago, on her wedding day, Clan Alpine had captured her and killed her bridegroom. In a cryptic song, she warns him to beware of his guide, Red Murdoch. The knight pays heed and is drawing his sword just as Murdoch fires an arrow from his bow. The arrow misses Fitzjames but strikes Blanche. Fitzjames chases Murdoch and slays him, then returns to the side of the dying old woman. She gives him a brooch that contains a lock of her dead lover's hair and tells him to find Roderick Dhu and avenge her pitiful life. Fitzjames sets out, stealthily making his way through the undergrowth. Many hours later, he comes across a lone knight from Clan Alpine, bound by the same code of honor as he. The enemies share food and a campfire, and the clansman promises to take Fitzjames back to his own territory. As they travel, they talk. The Highlander defends the ferocity of his chieftain, Roderick. He explains how long ago the lowlands had been taken from the clan, and they had been forced into the stark, inhospitable mountains. "Seek other cause against Roderick Dhu," he says. Then he whistles. And with his whistle, the woods suddenly spring alive with Highland warriors. The clansman turns to Fitzjames, and as the poem relates, he then fixed his eye and sable brow full on Fitzjames. "How sayst thou now? These are Clan Alpine's warriors true, and Saxon. I am Roderick Dhu." Roderick then waves his hand, and his men vanish again into the forest. Now that Roderick has led the Saxon knight into the lowlands, as promised, he turns and challenges him to battle. "Now man to man and steel to steel, a chieftain's vengeance thou shalt feel." The Saxon, who respects his foe, has no desire to fight, but Roderick insists. He repeats the hermit's prediction that whoever first sheds the blood of his enemy will be victorious. Fitzjames responds, "Then by my word, the riddle is already read. Seek yonder break beneath the cliff. There lies Red Murdoch, stark and stiff." It is clear to Fitzjames that by the hermit's prophecy, the death of Murdoch means the Saxons will be victorious. But Roderick stubbornly insists that Murdoch's death doesn't fulfill the prophecy. He calls Fitzjames a coward and scorns him for wearing a lady's hair braid, referring to Blanche's brooch. The taunt only reminds Fitzjames of his vow to Blanche to avenge her grief, and so he draws his sword. Roderick is large and powerful, but Fitzjames is quick and skillful. Eventually, his skill overpowers the chieftain, and Roderick falls to the ground unconscious from loss of blood. Fitzjames is in his home territory, so he blows his bugle and washes his wounds while he awaits help. When his companions arrive, he has them carry Roderick off to prison. Then he mounts his horse and heads for Stirling Castle. In the meantime, Malcolm Graham has also been captured by the Saxons. James Douglas now intends to offer his life, not just to avert war, but as ransom for his daughter's sweetheart and for his cousin Roderick. He enters the grounds of Castle Stirling and finds himself in the middle of a royal celebration attended by King James himself. Douglas, incognito, decides to compete in the games. A strong and agile fighter, he wins every event he enters. The crowd begins to murmur. This fierce competitor could only be Douglas of the stalwart hand. Finally, Douglas admits to the spectators that it is he, and then turns himself over to the king, who immediately sends a messenger to halt the impending battle with Clan Alpine. With Roderick, Malcolm, and Douglas as prisoners, there is now no need for the Saxons to wage war against the Highlanders. The king's urgent message arrives too late. Even as the horseman speeds away with it, fighting has already begun. The next morning at Stirling Castle, soldiers arrive and describe the bloody battles of yesterday. Now Ellen and her escort, Allenbane, arrive and seek audience with the king. When Ellen displays the ring FitzJames gave her, she is treated with respect and welcome. She is taken to a room where she can rest until the king is awakened, while Allen is taken to see the prisoner whom he expects to be his beloved master, James Douglas. But it is Roderick Dhu that Allen is taken to. Dhu wants the servant minstrel to sing him the entire story of the previous day's battle. As Allen sings, Roderick grows weaker. Finally, when Allen sings of the messenger who arrived with a flag of truce from the king, the smiling chieftain dies, with an image that the Highlanders have been victorious. Now FitzJames arrives to take Ellen to the king. She greets him as a dear brother, and together they walk into a huge crowded hall. Ellen nervously scans the room for the king, but she sees that all eyes are fixed on FitzJames. When the people before her bow down, Ellen suddenly understands. The Saxon knight is in fact Scotland's king. She too falls at his feet, speechless. FitzJames helps her up and tells her the battle has been ended and that he and her father have reconciled their differences. Ellen is ecstatic and tearfully embraces her father. The king, enjoying her surprise, then refers to the royal ring on her hand and asks, "What seeks fair Ellen of the king?" Ellen knows that her sweetheart, Malcolm Graham, is now free of danger, so she asks instead for clemency towards Roderick Dhu. But King James responds sadly, "Forbear thy suit. The King of Kings alone can stay life's parting wings. My fairest earldom would I give to bid Clan Alpine's chieftain live." The king asks Ellen if she has any other wishes. Does she have any other captive friends to save? Finally, when he has teased the blushing girl enough, he says, "Nay, then, my pledge has lost its force, and stubborn justice holds her course. Malcolm, come forth." Young Malcolm approaches and kneels before the king, who's inclined to pursue his play just a bit longer. He solemnly tells Malcolm that what he deserves are fetters and a jail. But when he sees the distressed look on Ellen's face, the king smiles. He removes the gold chain from his own neck, slips it over Malcolm's head, and lays its clasp in Ellen's hand. And thus ends The Lady of the Lake. The themes in the story you've just heard are common to Scott's work, and similar to the themes you'll discover in Ivanhoe. In both works, there is the theme of bigotry and racial tension, this time personified most forcefully by Roderick Dhu, the Highlander who despises Saxon lowlanders. Scott's condemnation of narrow-minded loyalties and fanatical idealism is reflected in the rash behavior of Roderick, behavior that eventually destroys him and that threatens to destroy many others. Through Roderick, Scott also makes a favorite point about the futility and ignorance of remaining fettered to the past instead of centering oneself in the present. Like the character Cedric, whom you'll meet in Ivanhoe, Roderick is a figure so embittered by past wrongs that he is blind to the opportunities of the present. However, The Lady of the Lake ends on a far more optimistic note than the novel Ivanhoe does. In that novel, as you'll see, prejudice eventually forces the heroine to depart England. In The Lady of the Lake, conflicting parties are able to reconcile their differences. For instance, King James and James Douglas. The sensible and compassionate characters, those that hope and strive for peace, are rewarded. Douglas, Ellen, and King James, through cooperative effort, all manage to bring harmony to the land, a harmony symbolized in the last scene when Ellen and her love are united by the king. Like most of Scott's work, the story is historical fiction, this time in the form of a romantic metrical poem. It was based in part on legends and folk tales, and then embellished with Scott's own historical research and his boundless imagination. However, although history was his fascination, it was never Scott's intent to create stories that were factually accurate. Rather, he strove to create an accurate milieu. His goal was to create a milieu so vivid that readers emerged with a feeling they had lived through the adventure and through the times themselves. Scott's contribution to literature was to craft exciting stories with vibrant atmosphere, atmosphere that possessed the reader and transported him to a different age. This rich, palpable atmosphere envelops us from the opening scene of The Lady of the Lake up until the conclusion. The reader can hear the trumpets blow and the swords clashing, can see the flaming cross of war as it's carried across the rocky highlands, and can feel the wounded pride of the Highlanders and the wild grief of the wronged Saxon woman. But beyond these specifics is the more important and less definable sense of the past that develops when we join Scott on one of his journeys back in time. That sense of the past can be so strong that when a story is over, we actually suffer a sort of jet lag, a confusion as to time and place. After The Lady of the Lake, as with Ivanhoe, we find ourselves blinking at our suddenly unfamiliar surroundings and forcefully yanking ourselves out of old Scotland or ancient England and back into the present. It is this deep sense of having been there that is the greatest testament to Sir Walter Scott's ability as a writer.
This is the end of the session.